important that we do look into the mirror of the Word of God. And so as we're looking at these things on, you know, the God kind of love that should be in our lives, let this serve as a reflection to help us to see, am I walking in the love that God is saying that I should be walking in His Word? Is that a reflection of my life? Or is it something, you know, that I got to keep working on? Okay? So in Romans chapter 5, verse 5, it says this, and hope makes not ashamed because the love of God, everybody say love, the love of God or the love from God or the same kind of love that God has Himself is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. Now, there are several different types of love that we see in the New Testament. Okay? There are several different types of love, and you know, sometimes because of how things have been translated, it doesn't break down, you know, exactly what kind of love it is. But there are several different types of love. And when the New Testament was translated from the Greek to English, these were some of the Greek words that were translated. The first one is eros, which is a self-seeking kind of love. It's the same word that we get erotic from. Everybody knows what erotic is, okay? So this kind of love is like a sexual demand type of love, very selfish type of love that is looking to have only its needs met. You guys understand? All right. All right. So that's one type of love that, you know, that we see in the Bible. But that's not the kind of love that is talking about here in Romans chapter 5. The next type of love is stergos. This is a, you know, a natural family affection type of love. We see this, an example of this in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 3. Where Paul was talking about in the last days there was going to be, there was not going to be a natural affection going on in the households, in the families, as we see in our current days, okay? There is an absence of the natural affection for family that should be and at once was there. The next type of love that we see is filio. And this is a friendship type of love based on mutual satisfaction. And we get many different words from this, like Philadelphia, city of brotherly love, okay? All right, there are all kinds of words that come from this type of love, okay? Filio this, filio that, and so forth, okay? But that's still not the type of love. That is a, you know, it's a better type of love, but it's still not the type of love that God is talking about here, all right? And so, you know, many marriages are based on filial type of love. You know, this type of love is like a love of a friendship. It's you know, it's based on a mutual agreement or understanding. So in other words, you know, as long as you are loving me, I'm loving you, all right? But you know, sometimes things can get ugly in there, all right? And some stuff gets said, and I don't love you anymore and all of that, okay? But that's filial type of love, right? So you can, just like people say, I fell in love, and then guess what? A little while later, they fell out of love, okay? And this is what that's talking about here, all right? That kind of love can be disappointing or can disappoint. But the type of love that he's talking about here is the word agape, all right? And this is a God kind of love. It's an unconditional love, love that has no strings attached, okay? Agape love is an unselfishly focused love that is focused on giving and not receiving. Anybody think that they have that kind of love? This is a type of love that goes to an unlimited extent to what the object of love needs. So it goes to an, you know, there is no limit, there is no bound on the extent that this type of love will go to make sure that the object of its love, that its needs are met. As the Bible says, for God so loved the world, it's talking about agape type of love again, that he gave, okay? So, you know, this type of love doesn't necessarily give according to what the object of love wants at that time, but But it gives according to what it needs. It makes sure that it receives what is needed. As you heard, the most important gift is the one that is needed, and then secondly, the one that's desired, okay? But this type of love, God looked at us and he saw that we were in need of a Savior, so he sent Jesus. Okay, he knew that we were in need of redemption, so he sent a Redeemer, okay, to redeem us from whatever it was, everything. And so this type of love will go to the furthest extent, okay, even to the point of death, to make sure that the object of love is taken care of and satisfied. Okay, you guys with me? Okay, it's Ephesians chapter 3, verses 18, 19, somewhere in there. It talks about us comprehending or understanding the width, the length, the depth, and the height of God's love. Okay, so God's love has so many different layers and volumes and depths and so forth for us to understand. And we don't just understand it by hearing that God loves you, but you have to experience this type of love to begin to understand it. So God has put his kind of love on the inside of us. As we read on Wednesday night in 1 John 3:19, it says that we love him because he first loved us. God set the example, or he put the precedence out there in order for us to love him. He first loved us. And now he's saying, I've put that same type of love on the inside of you so that now we can love God with the same kind of love that he loves us, and we can love people, which is more of a challenge, with the same type of love that God loves us. All right, let's turn to First John chapter 3. Guys, and got quiet on me now. Yep. That's it now. We in for the long haul now. All right, and 1 John chapter 3. Verse 16, it says, hereby we perceive the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to also lay down our lives for the brethren. So he's saying this is how we begin to progressively understand and recognize God's love. That with the same type of love that he showed for us, where he laid down his life for us, he says when we begin to lay down our lives for our brothers, our sisters, he says, then we begin to understand God's love. See, God's love is an action word, okay? And so, as he said, we cannot say that we love God, but yet we don't love our brothers and our sisters, okay? He said, that's not the case. He says, Amplified says, by this, we come to know progressively, to recognize, to perceive, to understand the essential love that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for those who are our brothers in him. Then he says in verse 17, but if anyone that has this world's goods, resources for sustaining life, and sees his brother and fellow believer in need, yet closes his heart of compassion, there's that word compassion again that we've been talking about, closes his heart of compassion against him, how can the love of God live and remain in him? So once again, you know, you cannot treat people any kind of way and think that God's love is abiding in you and that his love is going to be extended towards you. Because how many of you know, one day you're going to have a need. One day you might just be in the situation that person that you're looking at right now is in. And depending on how you treat them in their situation will determine how you're going to be treated in when you get into that situation. Or I'm going to say this. If you treat them bad in this situation, guess what? You've just put yourself in a position where now you're going to be treated the same way. And all the people said. So you need to watch how you treat your fellow brothers and sisters. You know, you got yours, but you look down on them because they don't have theirs. And so you think you can treat them any kind of way. You better look out. Did we not read Matthew 18 about the man that owed his Lord 160,000 years worth of labor? And then the one owed him 120 days, 150 days worth of labor. And he didn't have the same compassion that his Lord had on him with the one that owed him. Guess what? He had to pay all and his whole family. So you got to watch how we treat other people. God has put his love on the inside of us so that other people may see the God that we don't see through the love that we show them. Okay? So this is why it's important that we walk in that love. Okay? We cannot say that we love God and we treat our fellow people as any kind of way. Let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Let's see what this love is all about. All right. In verse 1, it says this. I'm reading out the Amplified. It says, if I can speak in the tongues of men and even of angels, but have not love, that reasoning, intentional, spiritual devotion such as is inspired by God's love for and in us. Let's stop right there. When it comes to us walking in love with someone else, that is the inspiration point right there. Okay? How many of you ever watch any decorating shows or you've done any decoration yourself? And you find this item of furniture or something, and you say, this is my inspiration piece. And so when you begin to, you know, put together things in a particular room in the house, you know, you say, this is my inspiration piece. And so I'm going to base, you know, everything else that goes on in this room around, you know, this particular object. Okay? And so when it comes to our love walk, our inspiration piece is the love that God has expressed for us and that is in us. Okay? See, the way that we should walk in love towards others should be inspired by the way that God has walked in love toward us. That should be our inspiration piece. You understand? Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 22. Somewhere between verses 37 and 40, he was answering his disciples. He said, you shall love the Lord your God. Or the scribes, he said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your might, your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. He says, on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So in other words, at the root and at the core of everything that God has ever spoken, everything that God has ever written in the word, everything that he's ever done, at the root of it, is his love that he has for us. He said, at the root of all of this is God loving us and us loving God and us loving our brothers and our sisters. He said, everything hangs on this. Everything has come about because of this foundation. It's hanging on all of that. Just like you have a coat rack in your room or your office or somewhere, and it's you put your hat or your coat on it and it's hanging on it. Okay, it's suspended, it's supported by that hook that's right there. And this is what he says, the love of God should be that hook that is in our lives, that everything. The way that God has, just think about how good God has been to you. The Bible talks about in Psalm 103 how God's love is as high as the heavens is above the earth. Has anybody ever measured that? Can anybody calculate how high the heavens is above the earth? He says, as high as the heavens is above the earth, he says, so is my love towards you. Or as it says, his mercy or steadfast love is toward us. Just think about how many times God has forgiven you. Just think about how many times when you knew you shouldn't have did that, but God spared you. He had mercy, okay? He had mercy. It says, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed your transgressions. Has anybody ever measured, okay, how far the east is from the west? You can't calculate it. Okay? Maybe God can. But we cannot calculate that. He says, as far as those things are, he says, I've removed your transgression. Why? Because of his steadfast love that he has for us. That should be our inspiration point. So when we look at the love that God has for us and everything that he has done for us, anything that anybody does is petty and insignificant in comparison to that. And this is what he's saying. That should be your inspiration piece right there. The love that God has expressed toward us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Okay? You know, he's expressed his love. He's given us all things richly to enjoy. He died for us. He was raised for us. He has restored us. Okay? Everything that God has done for us through Jesus, that should be our inspiration point. And so now we take that same type of love that has been shed abroad. That means it has been dispersed. It's just like it has been emptied out or poured out in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. That same God kind of love that is the root of everything that God does, that same kind of love we now have the ability to express towards men. And now because of that love, they can see God through us. He says, let this serve as the inspiration, God's love for and in us. He says, I am only, you know, if I'm speaking in tongues and that love is not in me, I'm saying all of these things, I am only a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And he's talking about, you know, in this city of Corinth that he was writing here, there was a lot of pagan worship that went on. And so the louder they, you know, they use these cymbals in their pagan worship, and the louder they crashed them, supposedly that was the more that they were getting into, you know, their spiritual worship of these pagan gods that they worship. And then also they also use the King James Version, it says the tinkling cymbal. They also use this as a sound that to alert them to war, that war was going on. So he's saying here, in other words, if you can say all of this, you can speak in all of these languages and so forth, but if you don't have love, guess what? All you're going to do is just going to be aggravating people where they're going to fight. Okay? You understand? All right? So he says, you're only a noisy gong, as it says, or a clanging cymbal. He says in verse 2, if I have prophetic powers, the gift of interpreting the divine will and purpose, and understand all the secret truths and mysteries, and possess all knowledge, and if I have sufficient faith so that I can remove mountains, but have not love, God's love in me, the love that he's expressed for me and that is in me, I am nothing, a useless nobody. Even if I dole out all that I have to the poor in providing food, and if I surrender my body to be burned, or in order that I may glory, but have not love, God's love in me, I gain nothing. So we see here we're talking about God's love that is in us, okay? So it's been shed abroad in our hearts. The thing is, are we in that love? Are we walking in that love? He says in verse 4, God's love endures long. Okay? Just think about how long his love is. And what that means is that his love is exercises perfect restraint of anger. That's what it means. His love is long. It exercises perfect restraint of anger. You know, he doesn't get angry with us very quickly. Okay? Thank God that he doesn't. Right, this means that he does not easily give up or bow out. He patiently awaits, okay, until the person finally comes around, changes, or the light comes on where you realize what he's been trying to get you to understand. Okay, God's love is long. Okay, it suffers long. It says his love is patient and kind. Okay. So in other words, his love is kind. He becomes the object of what love needs it to be. Okay? This is what it means when it says his love is kind. Whatever it is that he has to become or do so that the object of his love, okay, is taken care of, is satisfied. This is what he does, and this is what he becomes. This is the kind of love that God shows toward us, okay? He says, love envies not. That means it does not sacrifice anything or anyone to get what it needs or what it wants. It is committed to seeing others blessed and successful. This is what it means that when it says love is not envious. Look at the person beside you and say, is that love in you? It says that love vaunteth not itself. So in other words, love does not go around talking about itself all the time. Anybody been around people like that? You see them coming and you're like, oh, here we go. Let me get out of here. You know, they're always talking about themselves or, you know, exaggerating the facts or, you know, the things that the Lord is doing in my life right now. You know, you see those type of people, right? They do this for various reasons, you know, and a lot oftentimes it's because of insecurities. But he says love does not go around talking about itself, right? It's not boasting up. It's talking about the accomplishments of others. See, love is very secure, right? See, most of us are not that secure because, you know, people haven't shown us the love that, you know, that we've really been looking for and that we've needed in our lives. And so we felt the need, you know, to do these type of things that was not love. Okay? But this is the agape kind of love. See, God, you don't hear God going around talking about himself. He's always concerned about our needs. He's always, you know, I can see him talking to the angels about the good things that we do. Look at him. That's my boy. Did you see what he did over there? Did you see how he used his faith? Did you see how he believed God for that car? Did you see how when the creditors told him they weren't going to get that house, how they believed God, they stood. They marched around that house. They put the picture of the house on the tree. Did you see their faith in action? That's what I'm talking about. It's just a matter of time before they create planets. Can you see God talking like that? He says, love is not puffed up. That means it's not prideful and arrogant. Okay? It's not swollen, okay, because of pride. It says, love is does not behave itself unseemly. So in other words, it's not, you know, rude and thoughtless and insensitive. It's not brutal. Okay? Doesn't just lash out on you. Says love is does not seek her own. So in other words, it is not so bent on, you know, getting her way that she would manipulate. You know, love is not set on that it's got to be my way or the highway, or that it, you know, it does all kinds of things to try to manipulate its way into happening or to twist situations or facts. Okay, love is not a schemer. Okay, that's the devil. All right, love is not easily provoked. That means that love does not quickly and deliberately engage in words or actions that are sharp and bitter and sour. The actual word there actually comes from the same word that we get vinegar. You think about the taste of vinegar. Paul talks about it, you know, Paul knew what he was talking about here. He had I'm sure he was reminded of the time when he and Barnabas got into it. And the Bible says that there were sharp words of contention that went on because they were, you know, they got into a heated debate over John Mark. And so as a result of that, they never ministered together anymore because of that. And so he understood, you know, how sharp words can do. And this is why it's important that we watch our words in the church, and because our words have a great impact on others. Even after you've said what you've said, and you might have said, I'm sorry for saying that, but the words are out there now. The seed has been planted, okay? So we need to watch that. It says that love thinks no evil. In other words, it doesn't, you know, it's just not thinking evil thoughts. But this word here, think, is actually an accounting term. It comes from, what actually means is keeping account of the wrongs that are done to it or the evils that have been done to it. So in other words, you think about an accountant, and we're in tax season right now, and you got to have your itemized list of this and your itemized list of that. You got to have this and you got to have that. You got to have that documentation. You got to have this and that, okay? So you know you can get as much money back as you want, as you can get, right? Right. So love does not keep an itemized list. This is what he's saying here. Of all of the things that somebody has done it wrong. Right? And see, sometimes we keep a list of the hurts, of the things that people have done to us, and we replay them over and over again, and our account gets full, okay, because of these things. And so love does not keep a record of those things. All right? Look at the person beside you. Say, are you still in love? All right. So love does not keep a record of all the evil that's done to it. Love does not rejoice in iniquity. Okay? So in other words, it doesn't rejoice. How many of you ever, somebody that had wronged you and then something happened to them and you might have secretly said in your heart, they finally got what they deserve. Or they had this coming to them. And even though you know you're supposed to, you know, pray for them that despitefully use you, bless them and all of that, secretly in your heart, you were gloating and glad that they got what, yeah, what you think they deserve. How many of you ever did that before, had that attitude? So just repent right now. Because that was not love. All right? He said, love does not rejoice in iniquity. It doesn't rejoice in injustice or when, you know, in unrighteous or when, you know, something happens to somebody, regardless of what they did or what they said or what, you know, what they, how they hurt you. See? Right? It doesn't, see, love does not keep an account of that, but we should, you know, as we read in Matthew 5, we should be praying for them. Okay? Because, you know, they continue in what they're doing, they're going to get what, you know, they're going to reap what they're sowing. And so we need to be praying for them, right? So that God's love, as we said, as the Bible says, the wrath of man does not work the righteousness of God. We want them redeemed. We want them saved. We want them restored, whatever the case is. It says love rejoices in the truth. How many of you, when you heard about Latrice and Tim and LT got their car today, how many of you rejoiced? All right, see, love rejoices in the truth. It rejoices when, you know, the promises of God's word have become a reality in somebody's life. Love doesn't sit there and say, man, look at them. You know, you've been believing God for a car yourself. But instead, you rejoice and say, you know what? They got theirs and I'm next. You get there and you say, phew. You know how we get. You know the attitude that we get. See, love rejoices in truth, okay? It rejoices in truth, all right? Love also rejoices in truth from this aspect, when you hear the truth. See, this is the thing, and this is why walking in love is not an emotional decision, okay? It's not an emotional decision. Well, any of the things that we see in the Word of God, this is not something that you can, you know, that is based on how you feel, okay? When we were talking earlier about being in offense, and see, what the dangerous thing and the difficult thing about offense is that when a person is in offense, they genuinely think that they are right. See, that's why it's so hard, you know, for people to get over offense, you know, and to get it out of their lives, because they genuinely think that their point of view is right. And the person, of course, that they're in offense with, their viewpoint, as far as they're concerned, is right. And so we have to have something that breaks the tie, okay? And this is why it's important to love truth, because the Word of God is true. And so regardless of, you know, how we feel about the how we were wronged or perceived wrongdoing, we have the standard of the Word of God that we can always go back to, and that's right every time. And so this is why when we love, okay, the Bible says love, he that is walking in love loves truth, okay? And when you love truth, when you hear the Word of God that is truth, you might have perceived that it is this way. Your emotions might be telling you that this is how it is, But the truth of the word is what says this is how it really is. And that's what we have to line up with. Emotions, viewpoints, everything else has to come in line with what God's word says. And when we do that, then we show that we are in love and that we love truth. You guys understand? And that's one way to help us to get out of offense and into love. And so it's so important. I'm going to stop right there because we have been long today.